Exodus chapter 17. Pray for me too. Exodus chapter 17. Don't ask me why God didn't give me nothing in 16. I couldn't tell you. We went from 15 to 17. I said, Lord, it'd be nice if you'd give me a sermon, a chapter. But honestly, y'all, there's a lot of things in 16. That's the manna and all that. But the Lord just, he kind of just excited me in 17. That's where we'll be at. Verse 1. And all the congregation of the children of Israel journeyed from the wilderness of Sin after their journeys, according to the commandment of the Lord, and pitched in Rephidim. There was no water for the people to drink. Can I tell you this, if we just stop there, just chunk this in? If he gives you a test, if he gives you a trial and you fail it, be assured he's going to put you back in it again.
Right.
Hey, you know why I keep going through the same stuff over and over and over again? Because I keep failing. You know why you keep going through the same stuff over and over and over again? Because we're still complaining. Wherefore, the people did chide with Moses and said, give us water that we may drink. Moses said unto them, why chide ye with me? Wherefore do ye tempt the Lord? And the people thirsted there for water, and the people murmured against Moses and said, wherefore is this that thou hast brought us up out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our cattle with thirst? If I was Moses, I'd act like I was going up to the top of the mountain. I wouldn't come back. I wouldn't come. They said that a million times to him already. And Moses cried unto the Lord, saying, what shall I do to this people? They be almost ready to stone me. This is where we'll be preaching from. And the Lord said unto Moses, go on before the people, and take with thee of the elders of Israel, and thy rod, wherewith thou smotest the river. That's Exodus chapter 7. Take in thine hand and go. And behold, in this one verse, you get to see the Trinity all in one place. And behold, I will stand before thee there upon the rock of Horeb. And thou shalt smite the rock, and there shall come water out of it, and the people may drink. And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. And he called the name of the place Massah and Meribah, because the chiding of the children of Israel, and because they tempted the Lord, saying, is the Lord among us or not? Lord, thank you for your reading.
Yes.
Lord, thank you for writing a true historical fact down in the Word of God, that I might be able to learn about myself and about how good you are. Lord, I pray that you'd go by my pastor's way. Lord, that you'd touch him tonight. Lord, that you'd heal him. Lord, that you'd give him some comfort. Lord, I pray that you'd continue touching Miss Glenda. Lord, it's so good to hear good reports how you answer prayer. Thank you for everything that you've done tonight. And we want to tell you we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Historical fact right there written. I mean, it's a true story that actually happened. And it's pretty neat just to read about a historical fact. How God took Israel, his own people, from Egypt, and he's taken them to the land of promise. And he's showing you how he had to deal with them. And he's showing you how he's gracious and merciful time and time again. I mean, again and again, even what Brother Ray preached on Sunday night, you've seen the mercy of God and the grace of God and the leading of God. Even when the children of God was wanting to worship other gods, God was still being faithful. God still was being long-suffering. God still cared for his people through it all. Can I tell you tonight in your life that God still loves you? Still cares for you, still watches out over you, still supplies your need, even when you don't see it. Still putting you in test, still putting you in trial, so he can show you a little bit about himself and a lot about him, that you might come forth singing his praises. God is still God, and he's still doing Philippians 1:6, which is my favorite verse. He that hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. That's what he's doing here. I got confidence tonight that God's doing a work on me. All right, let's get back into it. And the Lord said unto Moses, now if I write in my Bible, some people don't, but that Lord there is literally talking about God the Father saying unto Moses, go on before the people and take with thee of the elders of Israel. By the way, I'm preaching on the pictures of Calvary right here in Exodus chapter 17. And the Lord said unto Moses, go on before the people and take with thee of the elders of Israel and thy rod, wherewith thou smotest the river, take in thine hand and go. Now, I like to picture things in my mind. My young people know I do. And so here's Moses. He gets along with God, which is what we all should do when we have problems and trials. Most of us complain. And then we go talk to the preacher and see if he can fix it. And that's exactly what happened here. Moses, being the godly man that he was, he went to God and said, God, what are we going to do? They're going to stone me. I mean, they're going to throw me out of the church. I'm going to have to go find another church. The people are tired of me. What are we going to do? And God said, this is what I want you to do. And by the way, if you read your Bible, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, see if it don't line up. It goes right in line with it. He says, go get the elders of Israel. Now, we done studied it one time back a little further, that last time he got the elders, it's about 70 of them. So he gets, in my mind, he gets to 70 people and he brings them up, and it's not done right to start in front of the whole people. It's done right there amongst the 70 people. And so he takes the rod. It was nothing but a shepherd's staff. And by the way, it wasn't nothing real big about the staff. I mean, it was just a regular old shepherd's staff, just a plain old rod that God chose to show his power through. The rod actually would represent authority, power, or the strength of God. The eye there is God the Father speaking. And he tells them, he said, boy, no, I kind of like it. Let me just back up, because this will kind of help you. Maybe it did me. Let's see. In Rephidim, and there was no water, people did chide. And the Lord, supposed to river. I'm trying to find it, because man, this thing sure did help me. Yeah, verse 6. Behold, I'll stand before thee there upon the rock of Horeb. So here lately, boy, I've been enjoying just looking up the meanings of names. Horeb just meaning a dry place, dry, thirsty, desert, desolate. That's Horeb. He says, and go to the rock of Horeb. He's a rock in your dry place tonight.
Right.
Don't think I don't like it. Anyway. Yes. So backing up to 5. He said, go get the people. Can you see Moses? There's 2 to 3 million people out there that he's been leading through the wilderness with this pillar of cloud at daytime and a fire by night. And every time it goes, he goes and the people follow. And all of a sudden, here they come again. If pastoring is like this, Brother Ray, I don't never want to pastor. Golly. And again.
Yeah.
Brother Tony, and again. You remember when you was raising your kids? Man. Did you ever say, do we got to go through this again? Hey, mamas, do you have to say, didn't I tell you last time to put your plate up? Again? You left the tool out there again. Here he is again. And he said, these people are going to, you know, Lord, he says, elders, come on. I want all the elders to come unto me. So he gets them all circled around. And he said, this is what we're going to do. We're going to walk over to that rock over there. And then we're going to watch and see if God does anything.
So he walks over there with the staff that God has been using through the whole thing. It's the same one that he smote the rivers and it turned to blood. It's the same one that he took it up and he waved over the waters and the waters separated. I mean, it's what God, it's the same one that he threw down in Exodus chapter 4 and it turned to a serpent. It's the same one that he picked that serpent up by the tail. I don't know if I'd have done that. That's why I wasn't called. And to do that and pick that serpent up and to turn back into a rod. I mean, it's the same exact rod. And he walks over there to that rock. And he just stands back and whacks the fire out of it. Water came out.
Yes.
Man, don't you think old Israel got excited? See God move amongst them one by one again and again and again. Don't you think it ought to have brought back to them elders?
Yeah.
We've been here before, hadn't we? Wasn't it back there at Mar where the waters was bitter and there was a stick thrown in and it made the water sweet? And here Moses takes a stick and beats a rock and out comes water. Hey, why are we still complaining? Why do we still bellyache? I mean, you'd think that's what they'd do. But anyway, it goes on and he keeps describing it. And it tells him to the river, take in thy hand and go. Behold, I will stand before thee there upon the rock of Horeb. And thou shalt smite the rock, and there shall come water out of it, that the people may drink. And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. Man, that ought to help you. And he called the name of the place Massah and Meribah because the chiding of the children of Israel, and because they tempted the Lord, saying, is the Lord among us or not? Now, Massa, I think that's how you would say it, is the meaning of it is testing or temptation. Now, God was testing them, but they was tempting God. The test was not sin, but the tempting of God was. There's nothing wrong, Brother David, with God taking you and testing you to show you if you're going to have the ability to stand strong in Him. But when you realize you don't and you get mad and you start tempting God and say, is He even here or not? Is there even a God or not? Does He even occur? Now, that's where the sin starts lying. And so then the place is called Meribah, chiding or quarreling. But now let's get into what I kind of like about the whole thing. If you read it, the rock is a type of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
The water is a type of the Holy Spirit. The elders is no more than what they are. The elders of Israel, the leaders, the ones that's supposed to be the spiritual ones, that's supposed to be keeping their household in order spiritually. Moses is a type of the law here. The rod is a type of authority, power, or the strength of God. So here we go. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. If you got your Bibles, let's use our Bibles tonight. We're going to turn to a lot of places. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. We'll start in verse 1. Moreover, brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant. Ignorance, not a bad word. We use it today as ignorant, as bad, but it's not. It just means somebody don't know.
Right.
Okay? How that all our fathers were under the cloud, and all have passed through the sea, and all were baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and did all eat the same spiritual meat, and did all drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and the rock was Christ.
Amen.
The rock here pictures Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Now start trying to put it all together as we read. John chapter 4, verse 9. John chapter 4 was in my Sunday school class. I'd get all the scriptures out and they'd find them. And then they'd read them. John chapter 4, verse 9 through 15. And he said unto the woman of Samaria, unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest a drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealing with the Samaritans. Jesus answering and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. Then the woman said unto him, sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep, sure is. From whence then hast thou that living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob? And yes, he was. Which gave us the well, and drank thereof himself, and his children, and his cattle. And Jesus answered and said unto her, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. The response of the woman. And the woman said unto him, sir, give me this water. John chapter 7, verse 37. In the last days, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. But this spake he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because that Jesus was not yet glorified. The water is a type of the Holy Spirit. Yes. Turn to Matthew chapter 27. Well, I hope some of this starts coming together for you. Verse 1. Now Jesus has done been dragged out of the Garden of Gethsemane. He's been brought up. And Matthew 27, 1. When the morning was come, all the chief priests and elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. When they had bound him, they led him away and delivered him unto Pontius Pilate, the governor. Moses, I'll go and read it myself. John chapter 1, unless you'd just like to turn and read. Moses, John chapter 1, verse 17. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. Moses represents the law. Okay, they're in a dry place of Horeb, and so now let's try to put this thing together. And then we'll get into the rest of it. Maybe it might help you. People complaining. Sound like us? They go to the man of God. They say, what's going on? You brought us out here to kill us. I don't like your preaching. I don't like what's going on. Feed us something. The man of God says, hey, God, you're going to have to help me. They're going to kill me. God comes to the man of God, says, well, I want you to go over that area, find the rock that I'll be standing on. Take your stick and smote it. God pointed out the rock. God says, right here is where I want you to hit it. The law was saying, somebody's got to be smitten. They're guilty. They're unworthy. They're complainers. They're backbiters. They don't believe in God. They want to go back to the world. They don't want no part of God. In other words, Ephesians chapter 2. They was wanting to run back to Israel. They wanted to hate God. They didn't want the things of God. All they wanted to do was complain. And the law said somebody has to die. God, being full of grace and full of mercy, wanting to save those, not willing that any should perish, long suffering in everything that he done before the foundation of the world, him and God the Son and God the Holy Ghost made a pact that Jesus would die on the cross of Calvary. And so long before that, God wanted to picture it in the book of Exodus. So he said, here's my son. He's got to die. And Moses, since you're the law, you're proving that something's got to be smitten. Something's got to smote. Something's got to die. That the water might be able to go out to the ones, to the undeserving ones. So law, smite Jesus. Here he is. Kill him where he stands. You say, do you think God literally killed his son? Yeah. Yeah. You thinking it was all about the people killing. Can I tell you, God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit had it planned out before he even created people. You say, well, I thought it was Israel that was so mean. Well, they was so mean, but can I tell you, you was so mean. The whole world was so mean. There was none righteous, no, not one. There's none without sin. We all stand guilty, but thank God there was a little bit of grace right there. That rock just bowed up his back and said, go ahead, law, smite it as hard as you can. So Moses reached back, justly doing so because the law said so, and I mean just took it by the word of God and smit the fire out of it. Say, what happened? Well, the Holy Spirit got free reign. Turn in your Bibles, if I've still got it, if I ain't flipped it over and lost it. Turn in your Bibles to Psalm 78. Let me show you what happened. Psalm 78, 13 and 16. He divided the sea and caused them to pass through, and he made the waters to stand as a heap. In the daytime, he led them with a cloud, and all the night with a light of fire. He clave the rocks of the wilderness and gave them drink out of a great depths. He brought streams also out of the rock and caused waters to run down like rivers. It was abundant. Think about it, y'all. You know, when I pictured this always before, I just pictured, Miss Gwen, I honestly, in my mind, until I read this tonight and God just kept building on it, I pictured this stream of water probably about this big flowing out of the rock. I don't know why I was stupid. That's just the way I thought. But it couldn't have been. You're talking 2 to 3 million people needing something to drink, and all their cattle, all their camels, all everything, all their sheep, everything they had to drink from that. Rivers come out of that rock. Rivers come out of that rock. It wasn't a little stream. It wasn't just enough for just a few and a chosen. It wasn't for the Israel, for the best ones that lived right. It wasn't for just the ones that complained. It was abundantly, it was sufficient enough for the ones, for the just and the unjust. For the righteous and for the unrighteous. Hey, thank God, because I was the unrighteous. Can I tell you that when the law smote Jesus' back, that there was enough blood and water come out of him to save the whole world, not just the ones he thought was good enough. He didn't pick and say, I want Miss Gwen to be saved because she's real sweet. I want Brother David not to be picked because he's just a hemp hill. I want Brother Ray to be over here. I want Brother Tony to be over here. Ain't you glad, Brother Tony? When that rock was smitten, it was for everybody.
Amen.
We don't believe in Calvinists here. I believe that that blood was shed for the whole world, just like that water was shed for the whole camp.
That's right.
I like it. Still like it. Let me give you some scriptures, maybe. Boy, maybe it'll help you. Talking about the Lord crucifying his son. Luke 22, verse 42, says this, Father, now this is what he's praying in the garden. And he prayed this three times. If thou will be willing, Father, if thou will be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. You know whose will it was for the Lord to die for you? God the Father. For God so loved the world that he gave. For 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. For he hath made him, yes. And I'm really wanting you to understand the first part of that verse. For he hath made him.
Yes.
Can I add in and not hurt the Bible? For God the Father hath made Jesus to be sin for us.
Yes.
Now, I'll be honest with you. I only got two kids. I don't want no more. But I'm telling you, I wouldn't turn my boy into sin for you, not one second.
No.
Not one second. But God did that for you.
That's right. That's love.
Revelation chapter 13, 8. The Lamb was slain from the foundation of the world.
That's right.
For man was even created. Before the world was ever even formed. If Jesus, this stuff coming to my mind. If Jesus is the beginning and the end, could he separate it from before he even formed it? No. Psalm 22:15. This is Psalms 22, I've always said this is Jesus' view of the cross of Calvary. But in 15 he said, my strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaveth to my jaws. I want you to understand this next part. And thou, God the Father, hast brought me, Jesus, into the dust of death. The Father, is the one that was killing his son. Another one that's coming to my mind. Genesis, and I believe, y'all can correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe it's 22. Ain't it Abraham and Isaac? Ain't it in verse chapter 22? Abraham and Isaac, he said, take thy son, thine only son. You take him up on that mountain. You sacrificing to me. You know what that was a picture of? The Father sacrificing his son.
Amen.
Isaiah 53:4. Surely he hath borne our griefs, carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken. Now, don't you understand this last part? And smitten of God. And afflicted. Verse 6. And all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord hath laid. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. Verse 10. Yet. It pleased the Lord, God the Father, to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. Boy, I wish y'all put it together.
Yeah.
Now, if this was really a type, a picture of Calvary, than God was standing on the cross and saying, hit him here. Hit him here. I couldn't have done that. I couldn't have done that. I'd have said, the law would have said, guilty. They have to die. I'd have said, that's right. Let's do it. And did you know he'd have been justified if he'd have done it?
Absolutely.
To every man and woman that's ever been born, if he'd have wiped us out right there and never thought of us again, he'd have been wholly justified. Except for one thing. Way before he created it, he said, you want to die? Yeah. You going to give y'all? Yeah. Are you really going to give me? Yeah, I'll do my part. Are you going to pour yourself out on all the people once I die? Yeah, boy, I have the Holy Spirit to pour myself out. And because God put that down in the commandment before he ever created, yeah, it had to happen.
That's right.
So in that sense, he wouldn't have been justified if he had done it, because God's not a liar. God's not like me and you. He don't lie. So here he is, and he said, told Judas, hey Judas, my son is hiding in the Garden of Eden. Garden of Gethsemane. You need to go get him. Tell him where he's at. I got him there, and I'm giving him the cup to start drinking from it. Took him out and grabbed him and took him all the way to Caiaphas' house. Right there, pluck his beard out. Right there, put the crown of thorns on his head. Right there, smote him on the cheek. This is where I want you to hit it. And the law saying, it has to be done. It has to be done. There's a picture of Calvary in Exodus chapter 17.
Right. Absolutely.
And this is what he told Israel. Don't forget how I brought you up out of Egypt. Don't forget how I fed you along the way. Don't forget how I gave you water along the way. What he's saying is, don't forget Calvary. Don't forget the blood that was shed. Don't forget the lamb that was killed. Don't forget the manna, the bread of life that I fed you, type of Jesus Christ. Don't forget the rock that I put out there in the wilderness and you slapped his back. Don't forget Revival Baptist Church, how 2,000 years ago Jesus died on the cross of Calvary. I don't forget how he was found innocent. I don't forget he was holy without any spot. I don't forget how he was brought up and they couldn't find no fault in him. I don't forget that Pilate couldn't find no fault in him. I don't forget that the priest couldn't find no fault in him. I don't forget that the world couldn't find no fault in him. I don't forget that he lived a holy and righteous life. I don't forget how they crowned the thorns on top of him. I don't forget the cat of nine tails. I don't forget the spikes that they drove in him. Don't forget how he hung there till he bled and died every drop of blood. I don't forget till he gave up his last breath. And as he was doing so, he was saying to Tim Renshaw, and forgive him, God, for he knoweth not what he done. I don't forget it. And yet tomorrow, we'll thirst over something tomorrow. And we'll go back to backbiting and complaining again. And don't forget, don't forget. The name of the place that was first there, I done turned it. I wish that Rephidim was done, had to give them another, Moses done gave it another name. I wonder how many times we get in places where God's wanting to bless us, and instead we leave that mark in our life. And it's got to be named Mezzan, whatever it was. To where every time we look back, we see our failure because we forgot what the Lord's done for us. And 2,000 years later, we're still doing the same thing Israel's doing. We'll complain that we don't have enough money. We'll complain that we don't have enough, a good enough car. We'll complain that we don't have a good enough body. We'll complain because we don't have a good enough church. We'll complain because we don't have a good enough God. We'll complain because we don't have a good enough spirit. We'll complain about everything that we can think of. We don't like the way things is going. We don't have a good enough wife or good enough husband or good enough kids. Can I tell you what God gives you is enough and good enough. Chapter 17. When's the last time you thought about Calvary? When's the last time you pictured it in your mind how Jesus died? When's the last time you seen the Holy Spirit flow? The next time you see it, they're back at the same spot. This is where I'm going to wind up at. God, same thing. People complaining again. Belly aching again. God, and Moses goes to God again. God comes to Moses and says, this time, Moses, I want you to go to that rock. Don't beat it again. Just speak to it. Water come out, just speak to it. Moses now, he's done had his belly full of the people. Yeah, people can cause other people to sin. He takes his little staff in his hand. He just laid back and smoked a rock. Water still came out because of the mercy of God. Can I tell you, he never got to see the promised land. Never got to have the victorious life because he didn't obey God. When's the last time you felt the Holy Spirit in your life? When's the last time you felt the waters run by you? When's the last time you seen the moving of the waters? You know what that complaining and belly aching is? It's taking the rock and taking your staff and smiting it again. Why don't we just come down here and just talk to the rock tonight? You say, Brother Tim, I've been doing it. No, I mean talk to the rock. I mean just laying it all out there. Lord, I'm a big complainer. Everything I look at, I want to complain about. I don't like the government. I don't like me. I don't like the church. I mean, just go on and on. I complain about something. We left the best church service last night. We was over there. And on the way home, we got behind the car that was doing 25. I complained. And then we wonder why we don't feel the Holy Ghost no more. When's the last time you just laid it all out and said, Lord, here I am. I'm just worthless. I'm just nothing. I complain, God. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I just want to. Can you let the water flow one more time? Would you please stand? The Father crucified him one time. He's not going to do it again. He will not do it again. And you don't need it done again. But what you need to do is have a good prayer and have a good talk with Jesus Christ. Would you please come? They steal enough water in that rock.
is still flowing. You remember when they punched Jesus' side? You remember what come out? Blood and water. Have you ever been convicted over your complaining? Really, have you ever been convicted over your complaining? I have. You ever asked the Lord, Lord, help me to make it one day without complaining? Have you ever done it? I don't know if I made it, but I sure have asked Him. And before I come to the house of God tonight, I said, Lord, forgive me my complaining attitude. One more time, I'm asking that you help me not to complain. When's the last time you asked God for that? In a thirsty spot. It was good that God led them in the wilderness. It was good that God put them in that kind of condition. It was good. It was wrong when the people didn't see the good. It was better when God picked out His Son instead of us to be beaten on.